No. That's
Jason. We're recording.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Bethlehem Lutheran Church hopes that this service of celebration in some way lifts your spirits and inspires you to lift up others. We hope that you enjoy it as much as we enjoy bringing it to you. Please join us during communion with whatever you may have as a symbol of the body and blood. Happy Easter. Join us with our Easter gathering. Early on the first Easter, Mary stood at the tomb.
She will see the Lord.
Mary wept, for she did not know where Jesus was.
She will see the Lord.
When her Savior called her name, Mary recognized him.
She had seen the Lord.
Returning to the others, Mary made her declaration.
I have seen the Lord.
Centuries later, we stand at the tomb and watch.
We will see the Lord.
Looking ahead to his promised return.
We will see the Lord.
Because Jesus has called us, we too declare.
I have seen the Lord. We have seen the Lord.
Our Easter gospel today is from chapter 20 in the book of John, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent down over and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said the things to her. Our Easter proclamation: Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Our gathering song today is "Jesus Christ is Risen Today," found in your hymnals on page 365, and we will sing verses 1 and 4.
Jesus Christ is risen.
This is the good news. The grave is empty. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah.
This is the good news. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never put it out.
Hallelujah.
This is the good news. Once we were no people, now we are God's people.
Hallelujah.
Christ is our peace, the indestructible peace we now share with each other.
Thanks be to God.
Our Kyrie today is Kyrie on page 184 in the front of your hymnal.
Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Our first reading today is from the book of Acts, chapter 10, verse 34 through 43. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message is spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. Not to all the people, but to us, who were chosen by God as witnesses. And who ate and drank with him, after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 118, 1 and 2, 14 through 24. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever. Let Israel now declare, God's mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation. Shouts of rejoicing and salvation echo in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord indeed punished me sorely, but did not hand me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. Here the righteous may enter. I give thanks to you, for you have answered me, and you have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our second reading today is from the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel acclamation today is the song on page 172, Holly, Holly, Hallelujah. We'll sing it twice through.
Descending from heaven, came and rolled back to the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy. They ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Good morning.
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 The message today is for Easter Sunday by David Trexler. You all know how we start the Easter service. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Well, we're not going to do that today because he was dead. He was dead indeed. They had seen him beaten. They had seen him crucified. They had seen him buried. He was dead. And with him died all of their dreams, all of their hopes, everything they believed in. They had even given everything to this man, Jesus, their past, their present, even their future. And up until 3 days ago, it seemed like a pretty good bargain. All he had asked was that they have faith in a mystery. And for the most part, they did. After all, they had seen the impossible. They had seen a blind man see. They had seen a lame man walk. They had also saw him raise a man from the dead. They believed with all their hearts in the things they could actually see. But not anymore. Now their beliefs were as dead as their master. There was nothing to do but go home. To leave their hopes and dreams and just go home. He was dead. Unless it was true what Mary had seen. She had seen an empty tomb. She had seen unoccupied grave clothes. She had seen two men in dazzling white robes asking her, "Why do you look for the living amongst the dead? He is not here, but he has risen." If that were the case, then he wasn't dead. He would be alive. If he was alive, then everything else was going to be all right. Their hopes, their dreams would be restored. So here's the dilemma that we face on Easter morning. He is dead. Therefore, our beliefs are dead. Our hopes and our dreams are shattered, and we might as well all go home. Or what Mary reports today in the gospel reading is true. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And everything is going to be all right. Our hopes and our dreams can be restored or resurrected. While I was attending a university some 33 years ago, I remember having a science professor who was slightly left of center. Anyway, it was before Easter and spring break. A student asked the professor what he was going to do over Easter. "Well, you've heard of Christmas, bah humbug," he responded basically in the same manner. He said, "The Easter story is nothing but a myth. There's no God, and there's no way a person rises from the dead." A young female student, who normally is very quiet, replied, "Sir, I not only believe in God, I believe in the resurrection." The professor replied, "You can believe in whatever you wish. However, the real world excludes the possibility of miracles such as the resurrection. It is scientifically impossible. No one who believes in miracles can respect science." So to prove his point, the professor went to the refrigerator, where he kept all the lab experiments, and pulled out a raw egg. He stood up on the desk and said, "I'm going to drop this egg on the floor. Science will prove that gravity will pull it to the floor and the egg will break. Now I give you a challenge in your so-called faith. I want you to say a prayer right now and ask the God you believe in to keep this egg from breaking when it hits the floor. If God can break the rules of science, then you'll have proven your point. If not, I will have proven my point." And students, that is what life and science is about. Prove your point. This shy girl stood up and began to pray. "Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that when my professor drops the egg, you will prove that you gave us science and make this egg break into 100 pieces. Dear Lord, I also pray that when the egg breaks, my professor will have a heart attack and die." Our jaws dropped. Now what? Nobody laughed. Nobody said anything. We just waited. For a moment, the professor did nothing. He stared at the girl, then the egg, and without a word, he carefully put the egg back into the refrigerator and said with disgust, "Class dismissed." That day, not only did I learn a great science lesson, but a great life lesson as well. The professor apparently believed in God's existence more than he thought, because he was not willing to bet his life that God did not exist. But you know, that's the way the whole world is. I read somewhere that 99% of all human beings believe in God or a higher power. The other 1% are lying. But when it comes to the resurrection of Jesus, the numbers go down dramatically, and most have their doubts. What if I told you that today, right here, right now, I'm going to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead? You are going to leave the confines of this building and you will know once and for all, no questions, no doubts, that you will be willing to stake your life on the one thing you are absolutely positive, sure of, Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. That's right. How can I do this? Well, he's standing right in the back of the church right now. Two things just happened. Those who did not turn around to look are no better, no worse than the apostles that lived with Jesus for 3 years. And they did not believe in him. Even though Jesus had told them this was going to happen over and over. The second group turned around for a quick peek. You wanted to believe what I said was true, or at least were curious. We are no better, no worse than Peter, who got up and ran to the tomb to have a look and see for proof for himself. I'm ever so slowly learning the valuable lessons of putting my faith in God's mysteries. Not having proof positive. I'm becoming more and more comfortable in not knowing the knowledge of God, our original or originating sin, not having an answer for everything. After all, get this, folks, it is faith. In the mystery of God, it is faith in the mystery of God that saves us, not proof positive or knowledge in the facts. The plain fact is that you are here today, that is all you need. Everything else has been taken care of. Your eternal salvation is secured through the cross and an empty tomb. Talk about a glorious mystery. In the very, very first line of the entire Bible, Genesis 1:1, it says, "In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth." Wow. Another mystery. Yet most of all, human beings, including the great minds, admit there must have been some type of a higher power. Well, I knew that. And if we can accept the very first words of the scripture in faith, then what, if anything, can keep us from trusting or having the faith in the rest of the promise? As far as I know, God hasn't lied to me yet. He is risen. It's not some cruel joke by God keeping you in the dark in certain things. The mysteries of life are what makes life fascinating and worth living. The mysteries of God are about the only thing I can count on to make my heart pound like Peter's. Some of you know that how much I love the ocean. I can remember that like it was yesterday when I was my very first encounter with mystery. I was maybe 4, 5, 6, whatever. I don't know. But I found this huge conch shell. My dad told me if I held it up to my ear, I could hear the ocean. And by God, he was right. I could take that shell home with me, and anytime I missed the ocean, I'd hold it up to my ear and be right at home. I love mysteries of this world. How about trees that go to sleep in the winter and wake up to grow new leaves in the spring? How do they know how to do that? Look at the flowers. Do they have some elusive knowledge knowing when to die and when to rise again? Think of a single corn seed, that once in the ground at the right time with the right mixture of rain and sun can turn into what? 500 brand new kernels. How do they do that? Caterpillars into butterflies. Birds that migrate thousands of miles without electronic guidance systems. Fish that swim upstream and wait. What about the most unbelievable thing? Babies that start from the meeting of two tiny cells and know just how to divide into individual parts and organs that make up a human body and turn into children. Talk about an exciting mystery. Sure, I know these events may be explained in elaborate words, but you can save your scientific jargon. I know all these processes and theories, and I didn't get off the turnip truck just yesterday, but any and every attempt to explain them is incomplete. They all fall flat. They cannot explain the mystery of our faith. Yet he is risen. He is risen indeed. We seem to let Easter slip in and out so quietly and quickly in our world. Don't spend some time in thought and prayer contemplating what God has done for you. Ponder the wonder and the beauty of the empty tomb. Maybe even get your heart beating a little faster, resurrecting your hopes and your dreams. My invitation to you today is very, very simple. Claim the mystery of the resurrection as your own. Don't try to explain it. Don't try so hard to understand it. Just have a little faith. The faith of a mustard seed in the promise of God who brings new life, and let God do the rest. And you, just like Peter, will be amazed at what happens. He is risen. He is risen indeed. God bless.
Our next song will be Just a Little Talk with Jesus. Join me in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Again, wherever you are, whoever you're with, please join us in communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." The table is set and ready. Let's say our Lord's Prayer first. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This is the body of Jesus Christ, given for you. This is the blood of Jesus Christ, shed for you. Gather into one by the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, today we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need, and those that you name especially in your heart. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all whom we pray for into your eternal care through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Please receive the blessing. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to a new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Our sending song today. Our sending song today will be "I Know That My Redeemer Lives," found on page 619 of your hymnal, and we will sing verses 1 and 2.
I know that my Redeemer lives.
Christ is risen, just as he said.
Go in peace.
Share the good news.
Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.